Welcome, everybody. I'm Helen. I'm here today because Pastor Jessie isn't. She's off with other adults and youth, hoping to make a difference. So today, we welcome the virtual audience, as well as those here in this sanctuary. How about we turn around and wave hello to those who are out in virtual land? Hi, everybody. Now I'm going to ask you to turn around and say hi to Pastor Jessie and group, just in case they're watching or they watch it later. Hi, Pastor Jessie and all, and hope you have a great week. Make a difference. We have a few announcements. Next week, Pastor Jessie will start her new sermon series, How to Be Blessed, and about the Beatitudes. Also next week, after worship, there's Water Day, and so come for a wet and exciting time after church. July 30th, there's Wine and Divine, the cleaning up group. They're doing it at 8 in the morning, so they're probably not doing the wine part of it. And we also have outdoor worship on July 31st and August 28th, as well as Together Under the Trees on August 9th. And hopefully a thunderstorm won't come in the next time for that. We're glad you're here with us, and we hope that Helen can pass some meaningful information on to you today. Thank you.
Please join us in singing our opening song, Give Thanks.
We thank you that your steadfast love never ceases, and that your mercies are new every morning. Today we ask for a fresh outpouring of your mercy, and may we begin to understand the depths of your love. May we remember that you have lavished your love on us, so that we should be called the children of God. As we walk through these turbulent times, let us walk as your children. Let us walk by faith in you and not by sight. As we walk through the depths of this valley, may we see you in the heights of your glory. Lord, we pray that you would calm the storm that is brewing all around. Amen.
Thank you, Kyra. And now we get to sing. Just too excited. Okay. Please join us in singing Give Thanks. You could find on Summer Songbook number 119.
first scripture reading for this morning is from Psalm chapter 56, verses 1 through 5 and 11. Be gracious to me, O God, for people trample on me. All day long, foes oppress me. My enemies trample on me all day long, for many fight against me. O Most High, when I'm afraid, I put my trust in you. In God, whose word I praise, in God I trust, I'm not afraid. What can flesh do to me? All day long, they seek to injure my cause. All their thoughts are against me for evil. In God I trust, I am not afraid. What can a mere mortal do to me? This is the word of the God, Lord. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, everyone. I am Debbie Barber, the Christian educator here at Christ Our Anchor, and as you can see, I've brought my magic bag of tricks and something that's a little bit too big for my magic bag. But welcome to Children's Time, a message for all ages, and because we don't have any little ones with us today, I'm going to be blessed by your participation, okay? So let's all do this together. All right, friends. All right, how many of you, and if you're online and watching kids, feel free to send messages because I will read those later. All right, so how many of you like a windy day? Anyone? Sometimes wind causes some trouble, right? But sometimes it's perfect for other things like, what's something it's perfect for? Flying a kite, right? So, what was the second one? Another thing, or maybe for sailing a boat, who likes to sail a boat? You need wind to sail a boat, right? Maybe not too much, but the perfect amount. So it is fun to watch a kite flying in the air, but what keeps that kite up in the sky? Anyone? Anyone what keeps the kite up in the sky? Wind, that's right. So have you ever seen the wind? Who's seen the wind? Right, you can't because it's invisible, right? But you can know it's there, right? Because what does wind do? Let me pull something else out of my bag of tricks. Here we go. Oh, wind moves things, right? So if I have my little wind, I can blow on myself, and my hair can, oh, well, it's not, and my hair's very damp, but if it was, I know, you can dry and move, but who has seen the wind move things, right? We've seen the wind move things. All right, who has ever felt the wind? So if I stand here, oh, this is so nice and refreshing and cooling, right? Has anybody ever stood before a fan so you can feel the wind surround you? Who has heard the wind? Who's ever heard the wind? How have you heard the wind? Give me an example.
With the trees.
With the trees. Is there another example besides the trees? I know, like, so if you have trees in your yard, you've seen them shake, you hear the wind rattle. Sometimes I could be asleep in my bed and know it's a windy day before I even get out of the bed and look at the wind out my window because I can hear the wind moving. All right, so here's my second big question for the day. How many of you have ever seen God? Like, seen God right in front of you? Anyone? No one has seen him because he's invisible, right? Like, but how do we know he's there? Let's see. We can see him moving, right? Just like that wind. We can see him moving because the Spirit of God moves men to speak and do things. Like, for example, this week, the youth group. They have been moved, they and their leaders have been moved to go to the city of Baltimore and do good work all week long. They're doing good things for God and for the community. And we can feel his presence, just like the wind. We can feel God's presence in our love. The Bible says if we love one another, that God is in us. What a powerful thing that God is in you. Isn't that powerful? Isn't that amazing? And then third, we can hear him. Who has ever felt a little tug in their heart that says, oh, maybe Miss Debbie, you should be serving ice cream after church today because it's National Ice Cream Day. I felt that tug in my heart. So if you meet me out with the ice cream truck from the food truck party, please come. You'll get some ice cream today. But you also can hear him through others who speak to you too, can't you? Have you ever heard somebody give you some sound advice and you're like, that's just what I needed today. That's just what I needed to hear. So you can hear God through others. All right, so when times are good, like on a windy day for flying a kite, and when troubles may come our way, remember that God is always with us through it all. All right, so let us pray together. Dear God, even though we cannot see you, we know you are with us because we can see you moving, feel your presence, and hear you speak to our hearts. Thank you for being there for us and moving us to do good things. Amen.
Please listen now for the word of God as I read the second scripture reading, 1 John 4, 7 to 12, and verse 21. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God abides in us and his love is perfected in us. The commandment we have from him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. Thank you for this reading. Amen. this morning and made me forget my paper. As I was thinking about what to talk about today, I realized I kept reading articles and book reviews that talked about all the tribulations and tragedies going on all around us and how we might deal with them or what we might do. I decided this would be my theme, and I chose the title, What to Do. How do we know what is the right thing to do? Now, first I need to lay some groundwork. And forgive me if I fail to mention what speaks to your heart. There are so many crises. Political issues, war, natural disasters, hatred, abortion, racial tension, suicide, climate change, gender and sexual controversies, drugs, violent crimes, the pandemic, immigrants and refugees, mental health, and mass shootings. While I was working on this, I received two different items that I'd like to share with you. Many of you know that Rich and I work with Golden Retriever Rescue, and we have two Goldens of our own, so all things Golden are of interest. Well, some of you might have heard about 10-year-old Ruthie, the Golden Retriever Comfort Dog, sponsored by Lutheran Church Charities, LCC. They have an entire canine unit to go out and help in disasters. But this really spoke to me. Ruthie was one and just finished training when she was deployed to Sandy Hook Elementary School, 4 when she went to the Pulse nightclub in Orlando, at 5 it was the Harvest Music Festival in Las Vegas, at 6 she went to 2 school shootings, Parkland, Florida and Santa Fe, Texas. 2019 was the Walmart shooting in El Paso, Texas, and just recently she went to Highland Park, Illinois. 8 different mass shootings in a decade. This is what it's been like for the last 10 years. And that's just mass shootings, not even talking about all the other crises. No wonder we're stressed and anxious. Ruthie went to other tragedies too. She was at the Boston Marathon bombing and natural disasters, and other comfort dogs from LCC went to other shootings such as Uvalde. Comfort dogs from different groups went other places. People needed that comfort. Psalm 34:18 says, "The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit." And I say, these dogs are mini miracles. The second item I got in an email, Reverend Quincy Worthington is a pastor at Highland Park Presbyterian Church, Highland Park, Illinois, where the 4th of July parade shooting just happened. I got that email on July 6th, and it included a reflection that he wrote. I've made some copies and they're out on the table. If anybody wants to read it in its entirety, it's fairly short, but I didn't have time to include all of it here. I'll summarize some of it. On July 4th, Reverend Worthington was visiting his ill mother in town, and they ironically had been talking about all the tragedies that were going on and how hard it is to know the right thing to do. And then he got a phone call from his daughter, who was at the 4th of July parade. She told him she was okay, but there'd been a shooting. His mother, seeing how overwhelmed he was, put her arms around him and said, "God is there. God is with those people, helping them through the struggle." He was moved. But he said he never believed God protects from suffering. It's an integral part of life. God doesn't shield us from brokenness, but he does support us through it. And God helps through our hands and our hearts. And according to Reverend Worthington, just when it seems that everything is broken so badly that it turns to dust, God shows up in the most profound ways to do something beyond expectation and belief. God brings healing and does that through ordinary people like me and you. So maybe we pray, according to the Reverend, we pray, we lament, and we get to work. I thought it was interesting that those two things came across my desk. And I knew I wanted to talk about this. I read where it was stated that God is bigger than the tragedies of this world. And even when we are afraid and don't understand, our trust in him can be bigger than our fear. Fear is loud, but it only gets louder if we feed it. We need to find ways to deal with this chaos, but not overly dwell on it. God's universe is big and all-consuming, and these crises are just one part. And to be productive and for our own well-being and mental health, we need to separate a bit from them. I'm not reducing their significance or saying we shouldn't be concerned. We just need to step back. Instead of watching the news 24 hours a day, wringing our hands and being overly anxious, because that just brings more angst. And personally, in our household, one way we deal, we've had our own trials this past year, but regardless, we start our day saying, "This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it." And it always seems to put at least a little bit of joy in our life. So, what to do? I propose we look at action, faith, and prayer. Taking action makes you feel more in control, that you're doing something, perhaps good, that you care. It can help your mental perspective. So what to do? Write notes to politicians, to grieving people, thank yous to nurses and policemen, whoever. Volunteer, teach Sunday school. Someday a child might make a better decision because of you. Volunteer with cleanups at missions, wherever. Donate to food pantries, to backpack projects. Now, we have a backpack project going on in conjunction with VBS right now, and those backpacks aren't full, folks. And now we find we particularly need lunch boxes, art smocks, and headphones. So if you're called to do something here, talk to our Christian educator, Debbie, about it. These backpacks are so children can show up to school better prepared. Also donate to reputable charitable organizations and disaster relief. Participate in legal and peaceful demonstrations and protests, and be kind. You can probably think of many things you could do, so act. Cliff Roop was a member of our church. Some of you probably remember him. He was a good guy and a small business owner. He saw something on the news that moved him. I don't really recall what the calamity was. I think it was in Haiti, and I think it was an earthquake, but I'm not sure. It doesn't matter. There was something. And Cliff saw children in need, and it touched his heart. He had two young daughters at the time. Some people say the Spirit was in him because he set up a collection, and I think with his own money, he arranged for delivery to this place. He saw, he felt, he acted. Cliff also went into politics and became an Anne Arundel County councilman. Sadly, Cliff had a heart attack at one of the council meetings and he died. A medical professional said, if there'd been a defibrillator used, Cliff might have made it to the hospital. There wasn't one there at the time. A core group of folks, including at least one of our church members, decided to get defibrillators in places where public meetings were held. They did. You see, they could not bring Cliff back, but they could give him a legacy to protect others. And by the way, we have a defibrillator right outside the kitchen on the wall, should you ever need it. And if you're not familiar with them, you can go out on YouTube and look at how to use it, but the instructions are in there. It even talks to you. So that was action. Then there's faith and hope. I believe in many miracles, and I have a little silly faith story to tell you. I got interested in bluebirds, and I decided our yard needed a bluebird house. You need to know we've never seen any bluebirds in our yard. In fact, we hadn't seen any bluebirds in the little peninsula where we live. But I wanted a bluebird house. And by March, the house was in place. And Rich, my husband, said, "Do you really think we're going to get any bluebirds?" I said, "I researched. I did what I was supposed to. I figure build it and they will come. I have faith." Nothing happened. But one day we came in from our boat, and I remember the date. It was April 25th because it was our wedding anniversary. And I headed up to throw a garbage bag away. And when I went into the backyard, I suddenly noticed a bird on the birdhouse. But foolishly, I kept on walking toward the trash can, and the bird flew away. And as it did, I saw these blue wings, and I realized I had just seen a bluebird. And I thought, oh no, I finally get a bluebird, and I've scared him away. He'll never come back. I've lost my chance. Well, I kind of lost faith for a minute there. But within a few days, he was back, built a nest, got a mate, and soon there were four little blue eggs in there. I call that a mini miracle. And that was 5 or 6 years ago. Every season since, we've had at least 2 to 4 clutches of eggs. And and to top it off, my fairly new neighbor said to me just recently, "Have you seen all the bluebirds flying around here? I love watching them. They're so pretty." And I said, "Yes, Lord, thank you." So I've been talking about many miracles for years, and I know the more I look for them, the more I find them. But just recently, I found out I have something in common with the famous pastor Norman Vincent Peale. He talked about the miracle principle. He said it was just 6 words that could change lives. Expect miracles and miracles will happen. Expect miracles and miracles will happen. It's a little bit like the glass is half full or half empty. If you pay too much attention to bad things, you start to see more bad things and it drags you down. But if you look for the good things, the miracles, you begin to see them everywhere. So have faith and look for miracles. And then prayer. I was coming down from the mountains of Pennsylvania yesterday, and I got to York, and a big thunderstorm happened. And I remember saying, "Dear God, please get me home safely. I have to be in church tomorrow." I went further along, it cleared up, and I got to the Baltimore Beltway, and another one hit, and you'll know that I was going 10 miles an hour on the Baltimore Beltway, so you know it was pretty bad. But God got me safely home, and what did I do? Did I stop and say, "Thank you, God, for doing that"? No. I quickly emptied what I needed out of my car before the rain started here. I thought I was doing pretty good praying, but after yesterday and having read a commentary on prayer, I thought I'm not doing the best job that I could. Because that commentary said 50% of our prayer should be thanking and praising God and showing gratitude. Of the other 50%, 75% should be about other people, situations, and issues. And that leaves 25% for you. Well, that means that in a 5-minute prayer, 2.5 minutes should be gratitude. And then a slightly under 2 minutes for others, leaving 37.6 seconds for me. A little over half a minute. Now, I know some of you are probably saying you need to say longer prayers now. But really, this does put the me in perspective. The article went on to state, a study showed that people who prayed similar to this were happier, they said they had less stress, and their blood pressure was lower. I've started to try to pray this way. I'm not timing myself, but I figure if I get the gist of it, I'll improve. So pray regularly, mindfully, and with thankfulness and gratitude. I say, act, have faith, and pray. We might just do a drop in a bucket, but a whole bunch of drops will have that bucket full. Now, you might have other ways to help you get a grip on these problems surrounding us, and I encourage you to use them too. Joan Chittister, in her book, Welcome to the Wisdom of the World, in answer to how do we know the right thing to do, says, at least until the present circumstances change, we must just do the best we can. So let's do it. Amen.
Please join us in singing Seek Ye First, Summer Song Book number 86. Now we come to a time for joys and concerns. If you're with us virtually, please feel free to write a comment about any joys or concerns, and they will be looked at afterwards. Do we have joys and concerns here in the sanctuary? Cindy? Others? Debbie? And his name is
Mickey.
Debbie?
Unfortunately,
Others? I actually have two myself. One is my sister-in-law, Sally, is having a very difficult time and is failing. She's going to have a feeding tube put in this week. So prayers for Sally with that. And also, following along on saying that we should have more joys than gratitude, I am grateful that Rich had a successful operation on his kidney and is recovering quite well. So let us pray. Dear God, we've had turbulent times. Be with us. Let us know that you are walking with us, and use our hands and our hearts to help remedy some of these horrific tragedies and prevent some of them also. We know that you give us free will, and we use that, but dear Lord, help us recognize that you are always there to support us and get us through. Help us too in knowing that you will always be with us, that you will comfort us and guide us if only we ask. Let us be braver in our asking for your help and in helping to take action and use prayer and have faith in you. God, be with us now. Be with the people who are hurting and grieving throughout the world, throughout our nation, our communities, our families, and we ourselves. Be particularly mindful of Cindy's friend as she deals with her complications from medical changes. Be with Mickey for safety on a cruise and safe travels. Debbie's sister-in-law, Teresa, that she continues to improve and has the needed support. Thankful for that. Be with my sister-in-law, Sally, as she gets a feeding tube in, and hopefully this will help her to get stronger. And thank you for all the joys that we had. Let us be more mindful of where we can thank you and show gratitude in our everyday lives. Help us look for those many miracles, God. Thank you that Rich had a successful kidney operation and has recovered so well from that. Thank you for other people who have had surgeries and proceeded to feel better and get better, and be with those who have upcoming surgeries, God. And all of the needs that are unspoken here, we also raise up to you. In Jesus' name, amen. So now, if you will, join with me in the Lord's Prayer in unison. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Please join us in our closing hymn, This Little Light of Mine.
I have to say thank you for bearing with me today. It's been a long time since I've been in the sanctuary. But know that we are not all in the same boat, but we are in the same storm. Some of us might have yachts, some kayaks, and some may be drowning. So please act, pray, and have faith. And use your resources to help those that you can. Go out now and take our church out into the world. Amen.
Amen.